We're going to talk today about the concept of bankful, which is used for both design and regulatory purposes, including designing stream crossings in accordance with the mass stream crossing standards and for defining the edge of the riverfront area for the Wetlands Protection Act.
The measurement of bankful dimensions is important for several reasons. First, it shows you the channel that's actively moving sediment and large wood through the system. And it also has important design implications for crossing structures that in Massachusetts need to be designed to the 1.2 bankful width standard. So we know if we have, for example, a bankful width of 10 feet, we know that structure is going to be 12 feet wide. And then that structure in the river can naturally function as much as possible.
Streams carry sediment, including boulders and cobbles, in addition to water. And these get mobilized and move around during the larger storm events. Those events that occur on average about every year and a half are referred to as bankful events. Bankful events do the work of a stream, and they are responsible for the erosion and the deposition within a stream. Bankful flow is the channel-forming flow, and bankful flow marks the transition between floodplain and channel processes. Bankful dimensions, such as width, depth, cross-section, and discharge, are commensurate with the watershed area. And we can measure these in the field, preferably in a stable stream reach that is free from impoundments or other obstructions. And bankful width can be identified through a number of field indicators, such as top of slope, the transition between herbaceous and woody materials, floodplain benches, as well as depositional materials such as point bars.
The bankful concept really applies to alluvial channels, and those are channels where water and sediment, wood and debris are moved by flowing water. The bankful dimension concept typically doesn't apply in certain channels, such as a heavily depositional braided channel. Bankful widths are typically much larger than what you might predict in a measurement. Likewise, in a confined area controlled by bedrock, the bankful dimension might be narrower than what you'd expect from your measurements in the area.
It's important to get these dimensions correct because when they're done poorly, overestimated or underestimated, they can result in ineffective sediment transport, either additional deposition or erosion, which could affect infrastructure as well as any restoration projects. So it's always good to cross-check our bankful dimensions with what are referred to as bankful regional curves, which plot watershed area versus the bankful dimensions. And these are useful to help confirm your field-identified bankful features.
It's critical to understand the stream type a project may be on so you have a suitable reference in that same stream type. For example, if I'm working on a riffle pool channel and designing a crossing, whether it's a bridge or a culvert, I need to have a reference stream reach on a riffle pool channel so it matches. If you are on other stream types, such as a meadow stream or a step pool channel or a broad alluvial channel, such as a braided channel, you need to find a surrogate reference that matches that stream type. So when you arrive at the channel, the first task is to identify the bankful indicators. Where's the break and slope that water spills out onto the channel if the river's not incised or cut down in the floodplain? If the river is incised, you often look for the limits of woody vegetation. And any depositional feature, such as a sediment bar, is typically within the bankful channel. You have to know not only how to make a bankful width measurement, but where and how frequently to make those measurements. So one bankful indicator is the edge of perennial vegetation, like these trees, as well as this step up. The edge of the bankful channel can vary as you move down the river. Here it contracts a little bit and goes in front of this tree. So as I step down, you can see the slow flat spot. That is a built up sediment bar, which now has some moss on it inside the bankful channel. Places to make your cross-section measurements are typically stable riffle crossover points. Once you locate these features, you can stretch a tape across the bankful channel and make sure it's level, and then you can read off the width of the channel. So we start the bankful measurement by stretching a tape and putting a stake in at an indicator. In this case, we have the edge of permanent perennial vegetation. Stretch the tape across the channel.
That tape is a good visualization of what that 1.5 to 2 year flood might look like in our region.
A laser rangefinder can be used to measure the bankful width rapidly with just one field person.
Measuring must occur at least 5 to 10 bankful widths away from a structure. So you have to get away from the influence of the structure, either up and downstream. And likewise, you often want to do several replicates of bankful width. We often do 2 upstream measurements and 2 downstream measurements, trying to find suitable reference locations to compare and use at a structure crossing, for example. You can record the maximum and average bankful depth. The maximum bankful depth is used to calculate the flood prone width, and in turn, the incision and entrenchment ratios, which we'll talk about.
So measuring the max bankful depth at the level tape measure.
And the average bankful depth is used to calculate the width to depth ratio, which is used in channel classification. The other variable we typically look at when measuring cross-sectional dimensions is the flood-prone width of the channel. Flood-prone width is the width at which the flood would spread out if it's 2 times the maximum bankful depth. So when you're measuring the bankful dimensions, you'll often spread a string or tape measure, level it off twice the max bankful depth, and see what the width of this is. Sometimes this is really hard to do in a channel with a very broad floodplain, and thus you would do it with a range finder or through survey or even aerial imagery or LIDAR contours in the office. And this gives you the flood-prone width.
So I've just worked with my field partner. We ran this string level at the elevation that was 2 times the max bankful depth. And we ran it out level so that this is the location where it meets up with the ground out at the edge of the floodplain.
The entrenchment ratio is the floodprone width divided by the bankful channel width. And thus, that's an indicator of how many times the channel can spread out during a flood. In our region, the floodprone width is approximately representative of the 50-year flood, so you get a good visualization of where a large flood in our region might spread out on that floodplain.
Okay, so now we've measured our floodprone width and found that to be approximately 100 feet, and our bankful width was approximately 20 feet. So the entrenchment ratio is floodprone divided by bankful widths, which is approximately 5. And so in this setting, the river channel is non-entrenched. Anything greater than 2.2 is non-entrenched and able to spill out onto the floodplain and dissipate its energy.
In entrenched channels that have low entrenchment ratios, such as 1 or 1.2, that 50-year flood cannot spread out. And this leads to highly erosive conditions that can be damaging both to the channel and structures and infrastructure in the area. If a channel is non-entrenched, it can really spread out onto its floodplain and relieve that energy, and thus less erosion tends to take place in a channel that's more connected to its floodplain. The next variable we're going to discuss is the incision ratio. And this is an indicator of how vertically connected your channel is to the floodplain. Incision ratio is defined by the low bank height of the channel divided by the maximum bankful depth of the channel. Low bank height is the first elevation at which the channel can spill out onto the floodplain. And you often measure this while you're doing your cross-section measurements. So when a bankful flood occurs, if the channel is connected, it has an incision ratio of 1 and the water readily spills out onto the floodplain. If an incision ratio is higher, let's say 1.5 to 2, when a bankful flood takes place, the water and the flood is maintained in the channel, and the channel is typically more erosive and more erosion tends to take place.
If you have a channel that's incising, the channel bottom is dropping, the banks are getting oversteepened. Those banks will often then lose their stability, crumble, and the channel will overwiden and overwiden in relationship to what its bankful dimension should be. Once it overwidens, the flows get shallower, velocities drop, and the sediments often drop out, and you'll get deposition, which can then cause water quality to degrade for fish and various macroinvertebrates in the river.
During restoration projects, you often design an incision ratio of 1.3 to 1, meaning the bankful flood can in fact spill out onto that floodplain. And this relieves the energy in the channel, allows the attenuation of sediments, uptake of nutrients, and also reduces flood velocities to allow for less erosion. An important task is to understand where your channel sits in cross-section relative to the valley. So walking that cross-section is really instructive to what the confinement in your channel is and also how connected your floodplain is. So starting up on a valley wall, walking across terraces if they exist, walking onto the floodplain and eventually into the bankful channel is a really good exercise. We often document this in a field book by a simple sketch showing what the bankful channel dimensions look like, as well as the floodprone width, and even up into the valley walls. This has really important ramifications for how you might design a bridge or culvert, where all that water that lands in the valley needs to funnel through the structure. And so these dimensions not only represent the river process, but they're also really important for proper design of resilient structures in the system.